Now we move on to session two on VA ECMO. For the same, can I please call upon Dr. Samiksha, who's an associate professor at Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia Institute, Lucknow, and Dr. Milant, professor at AIIMS, to please join us on the dais.
Yeah, good morning again. And to continue with the next session, now I invite Dr. K.R. Balakrishnan, sir, to speak about ECMO for heart transplant. I don't think we need to introduce Dr. KRB at this place especially. He's a doyen in the field of heart and lung transplantation in the whole of the country, and he's a name to come to when it comes to managing very difficult cases who are in the extremes of their heart or lung failures. Dr. Balakrishnan, sir, please.
Thank you. The topic is ECMO for heart transplantation. So when we first started our transplant program, we found that the highest mortality was in the waiting period, so we really needed to evolve a strategy for solving waitlist mortality. I use a historic slide. This is a transplant I had done on the 31st of December 1999, made famous by the Y2K, post-thinning biventricular heart failure. As you can see, ascites, no urine, and even though the transplant went well, she didn't survive for beyond 3 months. So clearly the need for mechanical circulatory support is evident. So I divided this talk into various indications for ECMO and heart failure therapy or heart transplantation. This child was awaiting a transplant, a 9-year-old girl, followed up as a DCM, presented to the ER pulseless. I think one of her younger surgeons, Dr. Pradeep, was on call. He took her to the OR, massaged, put her on central ECMO. And after 3 weeks of central ECMO, the heart recovered, and we did a biopsy. She had a viral myocarditis, and so the ECMO was weaned off, and the child is now surviving after 1 year. This child awaiting a heart transplant with biventricular cardiomyopathy had a cardiac arrest, was put on peripheral ECMO with a femoral arterial cannula. And after 6 weeks, the arterial cannula was in the middle of the night. So we had a massage taken to the operating room, put a central ECMO. And after another week, we found a donor organ looking like this, which was refused by 9 transplant units across the country. We accepted it, and the heart recovered completely after the transplant. And this is the child after 3 years. One more, early January 4th or 5th, called morning, this child again had a cardiac arrest. I think Dr. Veena was on call, massaged for 45 minutes. We took him to the operating room. He was decerebrating. I put him on central ECMO. And after 2 weeks in ECMO, we found a donor heart, which is on the right side. The donor had a cardiac arrest, so it was actually technically a DCD donation. We cross-clamped and brought the heart back. And the heart recovered, and he was shifted to the out of the ICU into the room. After 3 weeks, he developed RV dysfunction with a low-pressure TR. Suspecting rejection, we took him to the cath lab. There's no rejection, but he had a donor triple vessel disease. He underwent stenting. At the end of his stenting, his RCA occluded. So he had to be put on ECMO a third time. And he completely recovered. And he came back after 1 year for re-stenting of an occluded LAD stent. And he's alive after 4 years and doing well. We published this as a single patient receiving 3 times ECMO in the management of perioperative heart transplant. We also used the commonest indications of bridge to transplant. The first experience was, I think, 10 or 11 years ago from this young woman who was airlifted from Delhi, had 300 ml urine output, CVP of 28. She was sliding rapidly. We put her on a VA ECMO, and after 11 days, we got a donor heart. She did well. 5 years post-transplant, she had a VO2 max of 30, and she could climb Vaishnav Devi on foot, and she was skiing in the slopes of Gulmarg. She survived for 5.5 years. Developed tuberculosis of the parotid gland, which actually, despite us advising, they didn't treat it aggressively, and eventually developed CMV and tuberculosis and died. We've used it in children as well. The top right picture shows a girl smiling after being on an ECMO for a month because she just received news that she'd received a donor heart. And the right bottom is the same child 2 months after a transplant. We also use ECMO for bilateral lung transplants who have suffered preoperative hemodynamic collapse. And biventricular cardiomyopathy, the longest period is supported is for 3 months, and this is him after 3 weeks of transplant. Then we extended our indication to suboptimal donors. Essentially in this country, because of lack of affordable VADs, we had to use this. Our first was this 2-year-old child with restricted cardiomyopathy, 7 kilograms. we got a donor from Bangalore, I think. The donor was a normal child of 8 with normal peer pressure, so the donor heart couldn't tolerate the recipient PVR, so CVP is 19. He was supported for 12 days and extubated, and a month later completely recovered. RV cardiomyopathy, this child had an ECMO, was resuscitated after cardiac arrest. We got a donor heart after 4 days. Pediatric organ donations are rare. Certainly they were more rare 10 years ago when we did this. So we accepted this heart. The heart was not even beating at the end of the transplant. After 48 hours, the ventricle completely recovered. And this is a ventricle after 4 days. We've used it in adults when you use a patient's high PVR, TPG of 22, couldn't afford a VAD. These days, the acceptability of VAD is more than what it was when we first started. We got a young donor, 18-year-old, the RV couldn't cope, so he was on ECMO for 22 days, and the ventricle completely recovered. We started the project of extubating these patients on ECMO, so here, this is him enjoying the lunch on our previous hospital. I jokingly say that you need to be in ECMO to enjoy the lunch in that hospital, but as you can see, he's still enjoying it. ECMO for primary cardiac, primary graft dysfunction heart transplant. This is during COVID time when the donor organs were scarce. This is 14-year-old girl. She was resuscitated from cardiac arrest, put on ECMO, then a biventricular centrimag. We got a donor heart from Surat with severe ventricular hypertrophy. I think Dr. Murli was the physician who was in charge of this organ estimate. We accepted it against all our better senses because we had no choice. And we put the heart in, and the heart did not even flicker. So she was in central ECMO for 9 days with the chest open. She was weaned off ECMO, and in the 6 hours later, she required to be reinstituted on ECMO for 10 more days. And the ventricle completely recovered at discharge, and this is her 6 months later, and the picture on the right is after 1 year of transplant. So excellent recovery is possible if you have good perioperative support. We also used an impeller pump through the axilla impeller CP to support or wean off from ECMO as a bridge to transplant eventually, and this child did well. When there's no heart available after 2 weeks in ECMO, we convert it into a short-term LVAD. We can use the Rotaflow pump itself as a VAD because that's only 14,000 rupees. The patients can afford a centrimag, 4 lakhs. I don't particularly think there's a big difference between the two. We extubate these patients. We use the heartwire bag to make these patients walk. You can ambulate them. And after the end organs are suitably recovered, there's no rush. We go in and do a transplant. We use this strategy in pediatric patients as well. This is a 5-year-old, and the youngest we've done is an 8-month-old child. We had a situation where 2 siblings at the same time were on ECMO followed by centrimag, and both of them fortunately did well. We ambulate these patients on ECMO. This is a patient with VA ECMO, waiting for a heart and lung transplant. With a groin cannula, you can still walk. For those of you who are interested, right now we have a patient in our ICU who's had a HeartMate 3 implanted and a temporary RVAD support with a femoral cannula with centrimag, and he's ambulant. So it's possible to make patients walk despite a cannula in the groin. We have also used, though this is not the topic of my talk today, we also used VA ECMO post-op, especially in primary pulmonary hypertension with severe RV dysfunction and severe restrictive physiology of the left ventricle. Sometimes ECMO support VA is needed for prolonged periods of time after a bilateral lung transplant. This lady was supported for a month post-VA ECMO, post-bilateral lung transplant with VA ECMO, and made a complete recovery. What about the outcomes? We published part of it in the Indian Heart Journal last year. When we looked at Intermax 1 and 2, which would be the indication for ECMO, we had 34% mortality for Intermax 1 and 2 as compared with 9.6%. So clearly, this outlines the need for earlier referral for a transplant. And Intermax 1 had almost 50%. Those are the patients who were on ECMO. So when we specifically looked at ECMO alone, or ECMO to centrimag, or ECMO to LVAD, we had a 62% 1 year, in fact, 90 days, if they survived 90 days, they were alive at 1 year. So 62% of these patients could be salvaged. You have to understand that these patients were 100% dead if they are on ECMO for profound cardiogenic shock or cardiac arrest or Intermax 1 heart failure. So we could salvage 40% of them. Those who had directly bridged with ECMO to transplant had close to 48% mortality. But if you could transition from ECMO to either a short-term VAD or a long-term VAD, the survival is better. A lot of these results also reflect the economic realities. Sometimes patients don't have money and we are forced to accept them for a transplant or while on ECMO. But the good news is if they survive the initial perioperative phase, as this graph shows, the long-term survival up to 7 years is no different from Intermax 3 and 4. The outcomes can be excellent if the early phase is sorted over. So we also looked at, I think Dr. Murali is speaking on ECPR, when he first analyzed from 2014 to 2018, we looked at, I think, close to 24 patients who had ECPR in the hospital and were either transitioned to a transplant or a VAD. The duration of CPR support ranged from 6 minutes to 50 minutes. And I think five of these patients had delayed neurological recovery after cardiac arrest ranging from 1 to 14 days with a mean of 9 days. 21 patients had a transplant and 3 had a long-term VAD. And we had a 66% one-year survival, so we published this. The strategy of a transplant on ECMO or short-term support can be justified if a donor can be procured within 6 weeks and in the presence of biventricular disease and if other organ systems are not damaged. And in general, these things are true in our program. It's very seldom that, except during the COVID period, that you have to wait beyond 6 weeks for an organ. So in conclusion, ECMO is an integral part of heart transplantation, and these facilities need to be available in every cardiac unit embarking on this therapy. Thank you.